The following is a special presentation of HBO Sports.
He's a tragic figure, clearly. Someone who reached for the sky above from the mud below, but really couldn't handle it when he got there.
I mean, this guy really brought an aura of destruction and an aura of menace into the gym and into the ring. I mean, he literally had to leave three cities because he was hounded out of those cities by the police.
This guy comes from prison. He has these ties with organized crime, and he doesn't seem as though he's interested in uplift. He doesn't seem as though he's interested in wanting to make himself better.
There were rumors about this fight being a fixed fight. Could the fight have been fixed? You could make a very real case for that.
Sonny's death remains a mystery. His wife went into the master bedroom, and there was Sonny, dead. Blood leaking from his nose, had obviously been dead for some time.
Sonny Liston once said, someday they're going to write a blues song just for fighters. It'll be for slow guitar, soft trumpet, and a bell. Well, he was born on a tenant farm outside of Forest City, Arkansas. And incredibly, he was the 24th of 25 kids. Every day, he said he got whooped by his dad. In fact, many years later, when he finally drifted into Johnny Taco's gym in St. Louis, Johnny Taco looked at his back and he said, what are those bird tracks on your back? What are those welts from? And Sonny said, I had bad dealings with my father.
I used to ask him how old he was, and he told me that when he was born, they made a mark on a tree, and somebody chopped the tree down, so he really didn't have any idea.
He wasn't really sure when he was born. There was no birth certificate. It was the sense of growing up lost in a family, lacking self-esteem, which he craved all of his life. Thought he would get it when he won the heavyweight championship of the world, but in fact, never got it.
Hitchhike up here from down south. His mother came up here first, and he had a sister and everything. They were here. And I think when he was 12 years old, I think he said he hitchhiked up here. He didn't even know where his mother was.
He said he was in school. They were smaller kids, and they would make fun of him because he was so big in the same grade. And he said he had to stop going to school almost because they would ride him and joke him so to keep from hurting him or something. He said he just stopped going to school.
He eventually started playing hooky and dropping out and not going to class, and his formal education didn't get very far.
He never learned to read, never learned to write. You know, he eventually got into robbery and, you know, stealing $6 from this guy and $9 from this guy and just roughing people up generally.
From minor things all the way to armed robbery. And he eventually went to prison in Missouri for armed robbery.
After Sonny went to prison, a Catholic priest, Father Stevens, talked him into go out for boxing. And then after Sonny won the championship at the prison very easily, Father Stevens was so impressed. First he got Sonny a parole, and then later on he arranged for him to introduce him into professional fighting as a and got him some managers.
He won the Golden Gloves here. Then he went to the national championships where he had three fights. None lasted more than 3 minutes. So what do you do with him then? You got to turn him pro. There's no point keeping him an amateur. So we did.
The first thing his managers had to do was arrange for him to get a birth certificate, which claimed he was born on May 8, 1932. We know now from his early arrest records that he was born in either 1927 or 1928. In truth, it looked like Sonny was really 4 or 5 years older than his listed age throughout his whole career.
We got working, and I got a couple of sparring partners. It was hard to get anybody to spar with him because the guy had hands like hams, you know. They had to have special gloves made to work with and everything else.
After Sonny turned pro, it wasn't long before the mob, which controlled boxing, began to notice him. Not too long later, they took over control. He became a mob fighter.
Sonny Liston first got out of prison in the early 50s, and at that time he was taken over by the top mobster in St. Louis, Johnny Vitale. Vitale ran the rackets there in St. Louis.
Vitale also had a construction business, and he ended up as a strike breaker for Vitale, a head cracker in St. Louis.
Laborers got out of line. Sonny was the guy that roughed them up. He would collect money for loan sharks and numbers writers. He was the typical bully who used his size to earn money, whether it was in the ring or out.
And they said that he was hooked up with the mob, he was this and that. But to me, if he was hooked up with the mob, we sure were poor.
He was one of the nicest guys you ever wanted to see when he wasn't drinking. But when he got his little drink in him, he had a problem.
In 1956, in a brawl with a police officer, the cop wound up with a broken knee, and Sonny managed to run off with the cop's gun and a cap.
Him and the cop got into it, and the cop called him a black-ass nigger. He pushed the cop, and then he took the cop's gun, and he got 7 months for it.
And I didn't get him that night, but we got him couple of nights later. Of course, I took him in an alley and talked to him, talked his language, and he understood what I meant. Nobody want to get killed. Nobody want to get the head caved in. I said, that's what's going to happen if you keep fucking around here.
After that break in the policeman's knee, Sonny was picked up and put back in the workhouse. And then after his release, he wound up in another fight with a policeman. Wound up putting him upside down in a trash barrel. But now the police were tired of arresting him, and they just told him, get out of town or else.
Sonny was forced to move to Philadelphia, where his contract was given over by Vitale to Frankie Carbo, a known hoodlum, and his associate, Blinky Palermo, another known hoodlum.
We know that as of December 1960, Sonny Liston was controlled by two powerful racketeer groups, one situated in St. Louis under the leadership of John Vitale, a notorious union racketeer, and the other controlled by Frank Carbo and Frank Palermo.
He was managed, finally, I think, as a front by a guy named Joseph Pep Barone, who was a friend of Palermo's.
It was after he moved to Philadelphia that Sonny really became a force in boxing. He had a tremendous left jab and a great hook. And he just started beating up on people like Zora Foley and Cleveland Williams and Eddie Mation. He just destroyed people.
Well, from the outset, I'd say that Sonny Liston belongs among the five greatest heavyweights of all time. He had a left jab in front of him, which was probably the best in all heavyweight history. Had the kind of a jab that went through you.
Now, here's a guy who came into the gym and would hit the speed bag so hard that it would come off its hinges.
He knocked the stuffing out of the headgear. I mean, this guy could really hit. The stitching on the headgear, when he hit you, it came apart.
I think it's fair to say that he was considered like a Joe Louis, like a Mike Tyson, or even in the way that George Foreman was considered early in his career, as this absolutely fearsome, unbeatable force of nature.
This was the toughest guy on the planet. He literally hammered out danger. And when Sonny Liston came into the ring scowling at you, guy started bleeding during the national anthem.
Who do you expect your next real fight to be with?
Haven't I been having real ones?
Who asked the question? Are you over there?
After watching you spar today, it seems that you plan a vastly increased use of your right hand. Is this true?
I'm planning on using both of them.
Both of them?
Right.
Sonny was uncomfortable dealing with the press. So he'd usually answer a question with one word or maybe just an angry stare.
That's all I know is a few words, not said them all.
The Sonny Liston stare became known as.
He was suspicious of everyone. He didn't like reporters or the media or maybe even the public.
He sat there, this 14-inch face clenching and unclenching, and those cobra eyes staring at you. He was fearsome. The man was terrifying.
It's always been a struggle for any black person who becomes a public figure, because your image to the mainstream, to the American mainstream, is defined by essentially a white media. The white press had never encountered a person like Liston. Liston was not used to or did not feel comfortable with dealing with them, didn't trust them, because his experience with white people is that generally they're not out to do me any good.
It was not uncommon to read a newspaper story in which Liston was referred to as a latter-day caveman, a, quote, jungle beast, unquote, and, quote, a gorilla. I mean, it was that blatant.
I was sports editor and columnist for the Philadelphia Daily News when Liston came to town. He had a reputation as a fearsome puncher, as a potential rival for heavyweight champion Floyd Patterson. The problem was his name began to appear on the front pages of the newspaper more than in the sports sections of the newspaper. And immediately that turned off a lot of people. He had a number of brushes with the law, which were quite unusual for a celebrity athlete in those days.
After he busted the cop's leg in St. Louis, he was a branded man for any police department anywhere in the country. All of the Philadelphia squad cars had a picture of Sonny Liston taped to their sun visors.
At least there was an informal Bush telegraph at work between the St. Louis police and the Philadelphia police. The word had gone out, you know, harass this guy, you know, put the screws to him wherever you get the chance.
Who do you want to fight in the ring in your next engagement?
The man got the title.
Mr. Floyd Patterson, currently the heavyweight champion. Let us ask you this, Sonny. What have you heard are your chances of getting that title fight?
I think it's very good from what I hear.
There was an awful lot of controversy at the time whether this morally reckless person, quote unquote, actually was worthy of fighting for the heavyweight championship of the world.
Well, I've fought all the top contenders, and I've fought my way up to the number one spot. So what do a man have to do to get earn a shot at the title?
Liston's handlers were trying to arrange a fight with Floyd Patterson, the heavyweight champion, and with Sonny's already known ties with the mob and his arrest record, they were having a problem.
Custy Amato, who was Floyd Patterson's trainer-manager, he knew that Floyd Patterson probably didn't have a chance in hell of beating Sonny Liston, and avoided him and avoided him and avoided him on the pretext that Sonny was involved with the mob and that he was an undesirable and that the heavyweight championship of the world should not be contested by a man of his ilk.
Well, when a fighter started making excuses like he wouldn't want to fight another fighter because of certain things he have did, there must be some doubt in that fella's mind that he can't beat the other fighter.
Liston was very problematic because he had come from prison, because he had these ties with organized crime. And those things wouldn't have been bad necessarily for either the white public or the black public, except that he came along during the height of the civil rights movement.
The NAACP in particular was looking for black role models, blacks to look up to. Floyd Patterson was one of those.
The NAACP, they were very unhappy with Liston's negative image, and they begged Patterson, please don't take the fight.
They didn't want me to fight him either, because there was a good chance of him winning the fight.
And I guess if he should win the fight, he would represent the black race. I just felt that he is a man who has had a very similar life to mine, and I felt that he should get a chance, so I overrode my manager and I gave him a shot.
I think he's proved himself as far as being the number one contender is concerned. I personally think that he has every right to fight for the championship, despite his unfortunate background.
Customato had no choice. He had to make the fight. So they fought September 25th, 1962 in Chicago.
And Floyd Patterson came into the ring, obviously terrified. He was like Ken Norton fighting George Foreman. He was like Michael Spinks fighting Mike Tyson. All you had to do was look at their eyes. And they were out already. They already had a glaze. And you knew, looking at Floyd Patterson, that it wasn't going to last very long.
Public would let bygones be bygones, that I would be a good champion, maybe a better champ than he was, either just as good a champ as he was.
After Sonny won the title in Chicago, he was going through on a United flight back some of the things he was going to say at his reception at the airport. And he said, I know a lot of my own people were against me. He said, I want to prove to them that I'm not going to disgrace them, I'm not going to embarrass them, that I'm going to make them proud. So when we finally landed in Philadelphia, he took a step outside the door of the cockpit and stood there for a moment, and he was looking. I could see him look both ways, and it was nothing. There was no evidence of any kind of activity, of organized activity, in the way of welcome. And I could just see almost the air go out of him. I mean, these big, broad shoulders in front of me just seemed to sag with the recognition that there was no welcome here for him.
I think they should have a big parade, but it never happened. Jesus Christ, they could give the guy a break some kind of way. It was just a hurrah for 5 minutes. The man won the title. Anybody else, I imagine, it'd been 50,000 million people out there. Man with the championship, he's repping your city. Don't care what he is or what color he is. Give the man the credit, that's all.
A lot of people feel that that really crushed him emotionally and that he never really recovered from that disappointment or really the realization that it didn't make any difference what Sonny Liston did the rest of his life. He was always going to be branded as a bad guy.
Even after he became champion, the Philadelphia police, they went right on harassing him. They're just petty things. Picking him up for standing on a street corner talking to someone. For Sonny, the last straw is when they picked him up in the park for driving too slowly.
It was after that driving too slow in the park that he said that he was going on to Denver and that he would rather be a lamppost in Denver, I think he said, than the mayor of Philadelphia.
Sonny, now you just recently bought a home here in Denver. Thanks to Father Murphy, it's going to be your first home for a while.
That's right.
Well, by this time, Sonny had made friends with his Father Murphy in Denver, another Catholic priest. Sonny and Geraldine moved on to Denver. He wanted to be close to Father Murphy, and he hoped that would be the end of police harassment.
I think Murphy was maybe one of the few people, one, two, or three people in this world that Liston never trusted. He was almost childlike around Father Murphy.
Father Murphy was like a father to Sonny, and he would talk and try to advise Sonny, to help Sonny out, to keep him out of trouble.
Father Murphy felt sorry for him. He used to say, we have to pray for the poor bastard. And that was because he was an accident waiting to happen.
When he was away from Father Murphy, and when Geraldine, his wife, was out of town, he'd drink too much. And that white caddy is, he'd get in it, and he'd run stop signs, and he'd exceed the speed limit, and he'd get stopped over and over and over. Father Murphy claimed it was harassment. The Denver police said he was an 18-carat phony.
the police was picking on Sonny. When they saw his car, they would follow him. He loved to drink and he would get out of hand. He might pick up some girls and go to the hotel room. As soon as they saw Sonny's car, they would pull him over.
A few of the Denver police harassed Sonny Liston, and I thought treated him very bad. If he would step one foot onto the golf course where he ran, I was with him, they were there to give him a ticket on it.
For some reason, Patterson wanted a rematch, and in 1963, Sonny said, come on, I'll give you one. Of course, it was another disaster for Patterson, a one-round knockout.
Well, at this particular point, I can honestly say, tonight and the first time, and also tonight, Liston was a much better fighter than I was.
The public is not with me now, but they'll have to swing along until somebody else come along to beat me.
Jim Murray of the Los Angeles Times wrote, "The sports world must realize that it now has Sonny Liston to keep." Then he added, "It is like finding a live bat on a string under your Christmas tree." He was not a popular champion in the American press.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, the heavyweight champion of the world, Sonny Liston. So let's bring him on here with a big hand.
Even when Sonny started doing positive things, like appearing on the Ed Sullivan Show, he couldn't shake that image of this silent, sullen brute.
Atlanta, Georgia.
Sonny was awesome in his workouts. The highlight was when he skipped rope to night training. Image of Sonny, the ex-convict, the former labor goon, his known ties in with the mob. But the people that knew him, they saw a much, much different picture.
Newspapers painted him as a bad fella. But for people that around him and people he knew and liked, he was a good fella. He'd do anything for you.
The only one that really didn't get along with him was Sports Ride, because he didn't talk. They say, you don't smile. He said, well, do you be laughing when you go to work? He said, when you go in the rain, you're going there to do, I'm going there to do a job.
How old are you now?
31.
Still 31?
Yeah.
Are you ever going to be 32?
No, I'm like Jack Benner.
Get him out of here. Go on, Teddy.
Sonny was one of the most charming people I've ever known in sports. But he didn't share it with people because he had been burnt so often. Sonny trusted the everyday people, the inoffensive people, and the unthreatening people.
This is Dennis.
To Sonny, kids were no threat to him. He knew they were no threat to him. And therefore, the Sonny Liston that perhaps he was not, but the Sonny Liston that he wanted to be, surfaced around kids because there was nothing to be worried about. Somebody always wanted something from Sonny.
One of Sonny's closest friends was Ash Resnick, a Las Vegas casino operator with alleged mob connections. Well, Sonny was in Vegas training for the first Ali fight, and he was pretty much under Resnick's influence.
From the get-go, I had absolutely no doubt that the major corruptive influence on Sonny Liston was Ash Resnick. And Ash Resnick wanted to be seen with the heavyweight champion. If Sonny had remained heavyweight champion for 10 years, you would have never seen a picture of Sonny without Ash Resnick lurking in the background.
Ash Resnick started out with the Thunderbird, which was a New York mob-controlled casino. He was generally considered to be under the control of the New York mob, very, very close to those people.
Ash Resnick was the man that was pulling the strings for Sonny to do a lot of things. And so we did. We enjoyed ourselves, gambling and the girls.
Ash Resnick had somehow or other mesmerized him into thinking that he was a super being that didn't have to train, that could live by his own rules. It corrupted. It was a corruption.
Resnick wasn't the only problem for Sonny at that time. While training for the second Patterson fight, Liston began getting harassed by Cassius Clay, then no more than a young, loudmouth heavyweight contender out of Miami.
I saw Sonny Liston a few days ago, Cassius.
Ain't he ugly? He's too ugly to be the world's champ. The world's champ should be pretty like me.
Don't you have any respect for him at all as a fighter?
As a fighter? I think he should be locked up for impersonating a fighter.
I think the seeds for Sonny's destruction at the hands of Clay began in the last few days before the second Patterson fight. As we were crossing the casino, Liston stopped dead in his tracks and he held up his hand like this for the whole entourage. The people are bumping into him from behind. You know, everybody stopped when he stopped. He pointed over on his right-hand side, and over at the crap tables was Cassius Clay. Clay looked up, and Liston smacked him right across the mouth as he looked up. Whack! Smacked him right across the mouth. Clay said, what'd you do that for? And Sonny said, because you too bleeding fresh. And he turned around and just walked away, and everybody's walking with him. And Sonny said, I got the punk's heart.
He felt invincible. He felt that he could knock anybody out. So Sonny was, you know, full of himself. He was overconfident. He was running around with women other than his wife.
He was doing things that no fighter should do. He was dissipating and very, very little real work training for the fight with Clay. There were legitimate fighters who were lined up as sparring partners. Sonny wouldn't touch him. Sonny wouldn't get into the same ring with them. He felt that he didn't need it because he thought he was going to go through Clay like a wet paper bag.
What about Cassius?
Well, I would imagine if he would come to me, I'd kill him. And if he run, I'm going to catch him and kill him.
You tell him to your camera, your TV man, your radio man, and you right by the whole world. If Sonny Liston whoops me, I'll kiss his feet in the rain.
To say that Clay wasn't taken seriously as an opponent for Liston before their first fight is an understatement. Nobody knew what Cassius Clay would become.
This was a very confusing time for people. Clay wasn't liked because he was a braggart who hadn't really proved himself. And guys would say, I'd like to see Sonny button his lip. But on the other hand, they didn't want Sonny either. And so there was this curious kind of sense of not knowing exactly who to pull for.
Going into the fight, you have the situation at the weigh-in. Sonny thought that he would give, Ollie the old stare down, give him the evil eye, you know, scare the crap out of him, and that would be it. But at the weigh-in, Sonny was completely upstaged. I mean, Ali completely freaked out.
I predict that tonight somebody will die at ringside from shock.
The opinion of most of the observers was that these hysterics that Clay was going through were fear. But of course they weren't. He was psyching the old bear out.
Clay and Liston finally met in Miami Beach on February 25th, 1964.
I think that what happened that night was that Sonny really expected that when he took his robe off, that Clay was going to be just about ready to collapse.
Well, the first thing that occurred to me was that Clay had a plan and seemed to have the quickness and the nerve to deal with this malevolent force. In and out, punch, hold. There was something happening in there that we couldn't all quite understand. Everyone thought, well, sooner or later, he's going to stop and Liston is going to hit him. But then it became apparent that Liston was getting a little frustrated.
Sonny suddenly realized, wow, this is something I've never, never been up against in the ring. Here was a finely tuned, magnificent young athlete in front of him. And here was an out-of-shape, middle-aged guy who didn't train a lick and thought he was just going to go in there, throw a few punches, and it would be all over.
The next shocking thing that happened was when Clay was having difficulty in his corner between the fourth and fifth rounds, something in his eyes, nobody knew exactly what it was.
He told Angelo Dundee, his trainer, he said he was blind, he couldn't see. He wanted to quit. Dundee sent him back out there. He said, if you can't fight, run.
Angelo just told him, he said, just stay away from him until he'll go away.
Ladies and gentlemen, we don't know exactly what happened. They're yelling from Cassius Clay's corner. Something got in his right eye. However, he's blinking badly. Sonny's got to try to part on.
Cassius did get hit a few times, but not enough to really hurt him. And in the middle of that next round, the burning stopped.
And when his vision came back, then he started to take Sonny apart. Pop, 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 pop. Good, sharp, quick. He was never a heavy puncher, but a sharp, you know, ripping puncher. And you see Sonny start to bust up.
Then, before the start of the seventh round, one of the last things anyone ever expected happened.
They might be stopping it. That might be all, ladies and gentlemen.
When the bell rang, Sonny just sat there and said, that's it. And he wouldn't go out. So they called over the referee and told him that he'd hurt his shoulder.
When I threw the punch with the left, and I went back to my corner, the whole glove felt like it was full of water. And when I raised my arm, it would felt like it was lead in the glove.
Most heavyweight champions would rather be carried out on their shield than to quit on a stool. But that's what Liston chose to do, and a lot of people felt that the fight was fixed. He was a heavy favorite.
Well, remember now, the odds were 8-1 in Liston's favor going into the fight. And there are a lot of people who believe that the mob, which controlled Liston, had him take a dive, made a great betting coup, because they knew they could get a rematch.
I knew that Sonny had to lose one way or the other. Sonny told me, he said, Fanita, I'm going to tell you when I got to drop it. He didn't, though. He didn't tell me. But I felt like I knew because they wouldn't let me go with him to train with the guy.
Whoever tells you that this was a great gambling coup engineered by the mafia, either needs to change whatever it is they're smoking or needs to find out what they're talking about.
It's preposterous. There is just, in my mind, not any slim area of doubt that that could have been the case.
Nobody can show me why Sonny Liston would give up the heavyweight championship of the world. Why would the mob, which controlled Liston, want to give up control to Muhammad Ali, to which it had no ties? Where is the evidence of betting coups? I've never seen it.
You can't call it a fix. You can't call it a fix because I didn't stop the fight. The doctors had to stop it. Oh, I'm so pretty. I shook up the world.
If there was a fix, then Joe Pelino told me a totally phony story about trying to blind Clay. And I don't see why anybody would tell a story like that. What happened was when Liston realized that this guy wasn't going, and Liston knew, he had to know, that he was not prepared to go the championship distance. He wasn't prepared to go a good strong 8 rounds, let alone 15 rounds. And when Liston realized this, he told Joe Pelino to use an application that Joe had in a bottle, and to use the application on his gloves.
So Joe Pelino, during the break between one of the rounds, smeared this stuff on Sonny's glove and then threw the stuff underneath the ring as far as he could. And Sonny went out there and he got it in Clay's eyes and Clay could not see.
When it was obvious that Clay did not have any vision at all, and Sonny started to tee off at him. And look at that round. And look at some of the thunderous shots that Clay took. And he stood up, and fortunately, perspiration cleared up the stuff that was in Clay's eyes, and his vision came back, and he came on to win the fight. And Sonny said, that's it. And that was it. He just didn't come out. And all the rest of that stuff about, you know, a bad shoulder, bursitis, that was all contrived after the fight.
Sonny confirmed what a lot of people were suspecting at the time, that in fact he was a bully, a neighborhood bully type, and that if things went badly for him, that he would fold his hand. Rather than get beat up and humiliated by this kid, he decided to say, I'm not going to fight anymore. And he really, at that point, dishonored himself and dishonored the heavyweight championship of the world.
You expect to get a rematch?
Well, if Clay want to give me a rematch, I'll take it. And if he don't, imagine I'll forget it.
This was a real wake-up call for Sonny Liston. You know, he suddenly realized that, you know, he could be beaten, and he could be beaten by this young whippersnapper with the big mouth. And he was deeply ashamed, because this was the thing that gave Sonny his identity. He was the toughest guy in the world. And suddenly he woke up one morning and he wasn't the toughest guy in the world. So he decided to do something about it. And he trained like he hadn't trained in years.
Do you feel you're sharper physically than you've been in the past?
Yes, I do. I feel that I'm in the best shape of my life.
There are many people that feel that if the second fight had come off as scheduled, Sonny would have regained the title.
Ali unexpectedly came up with a hernia, and the fight was postponed.
Well, the defense attorney just announced to the court the fight would not be held in Boston.
This second fight had a real stench about it, and nobody wanted it. One of the problems was that during a recent Senate investigation, Liston's managers had been grilled about the possibility that the first fight in Miami had been fixed by the mob.
The day after the fight in Miami Beach, did you have a meeting or any conversations in a group with Mr. Margolis, Mr. Barone, Mr. Resnick, and Mr. Dundee?
Honestly, Mr. Thorne, I cannot answer it.
And by now, the FBI was even investigating leads that there might be a fix in the works for the second fight.
John Vitale was living at that time, and he says, don't pay any attention to what you hear about the next fight. You ought to be glad you're not going with them. And I said, why is that? He said, the fight's going to be a one-round fight.
As bad as all this may have looked, people seem to feel even more threatened by Clay's new allegiance to this mysterious Nation of Islam.
Why do you insist on being called Muhammad Ali now?
Well, that's the name given to me by my leading teacher, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. That's my original name. That's a black man name. Cassius Clay was my slave name. I'm no longer a slave.
There were articles that said, oh, it's much better to have organized crime running boxing than have the Muslims running boxing. Which I thought was a rather incredible statement. I mean, considering that, you know, the Muslims hadn't done anything nearly to the United States that organized crime had done. The racial phobia was just, it was just incredible.
They had said that he would, Liston would tear up that pretty face of you. But Allah and myself said no, no.
If the Muslims had a stake in this thing, it wasn't the dollars in the heavyweight championship. The value of Ali winning that fight to the Muslims, this was finally the name on the stationery. That's what was important about it. And don't let anybody kid you about anything else. He was the name that everybody knew. He was the man. And worldwide, the heavyweight champion is, that's it, he's the man. And now they had the man.
I personally checked with the Attorney General to see if he knew of any reason, illegal or otherwise, why we should not invite this match to come to Maine.
Finally, in spite of all the controversy swirling around the fight, the little town of Lewis and Maine agreed to take it.
A lot politically had happened. Ali announced that he was joining the movement. He announced the name change. Malcolm X has left the movement. Malcolm X was assassinated a few months before the second fight. So it's very, very charged politically.
A carload of men can be coming from New York to get somebody, and you can't go get them. What kind of law is this here in America? The world's watching you.
Police authorities came to us and told us that assassins was coming from New York to assassinate Muhammad Ali for revenge of Malcolm being
assassinated.
What you come to tell me they're coming to get me for? Why don't you go on the highway and stop them?
And there is Liston. I mean, there's this Liston standing there before this entire drama, which I'm sure must have bewildered him as much as it bewildered anyone else.
You see, I got them police out there. And they got some very vicious dogs. He can come if he wanna. But he better have some padded behind.
By this time, there was so much paranoia over the so-called assassination attempt that as you entered the arena, this little hockey rink is what it really was, everyone was searched.
This had to be the most chaotic fight of all time.
You both know the rules of Maine.
I mean, this was like a wrestling match. It was as chaotic as that, and it looked as staged. It really had a stink to it.
We note that early, halfway through this first round, that Sonny is shooting mostly, although he's going to the head now, mostly toward that body. You know the old story, you kill the body and the head might follow.
Wolsey was still on the canvas. There were yells of fix from the crowd. Jersey Joe Walcott, the former heavyweight champion of the world, great guy, great fighter, lousy referee. He failed to pick up the timekeeper's count. Liston got up. And finally, Nat Fleischer attracted Walcott's attention. He said, you know, Sonny was down for over 10 seconds. The fight is over. And boy, all hell broke loose then.
There was a punch, and a hard punch that landed in a vulnerable place. There is footage that shows Liston's neck being snapped back by that punch.
The thing that bothered me is Liston could take a hell of a punch. I'd seen him fight guys that were devastating punches. I've seen him fight those guys. I've seen those guys knock the daylights out of him for a while, but then he would always come on to knock him out.
Ali hit him so fast, Ali really didn't know he hit him. Because I took the mouthpiece out of Ali's mouth in that fight. And he told me, he said, he laid down. I said, no. I said, you hit him. So he asked me, he said, man, I think he laid. I said, no, man, you hit him. And it took a long time before he saw the punch that he hit Sonny with.
What did you think of the fight last night?
I think it was a fake fight, very fake.
Well, what did you think of
it? I thought it was a phony.
Let me tell you, the minute he hit the floor, I heard, they said, fix! And you could hear the rain. Did you hear the people hollering, fix?
Yeah, I heard it.
I heard him say, fix, soon as he fell. I said, get up! Come on! I mean, fix. I don't know nothing about no fix.
The story that I have got from various members of Sonny's camp was that two fellas did come up to training camp and represented themselves as black Muslims.
They called on Sonny, and they spoke to him privately, and that they told Sonny that if he won the rematch, that he was a dead man.
Could that have happened? Sure. Should it have intimidated Sonny Liston? Why? Sonny Liston had the mob in his corner. He had come from a mob background. Why should he be afraid of a couple of well-dressed, in effect, mobsters who are threatening him? Sonny Liston was the most threatening guy around.
We've learned that there very definitely had been a fix in that fight. Another guy who was very, very close to the mob in Chicago, a guy by the name of Bernie Glickman, was very, very close to Liston. And while he was conversing with Liston before the fight and with Geraldine said to Liston that as long as he had to dump the fight, don't take a chance of getting hurt. As long as you're going to lose anyhow, go ahead down, go down early. And of course, he went down in the first round.
If he threw the fight, he went to his grave. He never told me. And if he threw it, I didn't see none of the money.
I went in the back in the dressing room, and he was all by himself. I said to him, I know how you feel. I've experienced this myself. He didn't say one word. He didn't say anything. He just kept looking and looking. And he had that mean look on his face. And I don't think he knew he had the mean look, but I kept on talking anyway. And finally I said, I don't think I'm reaching him. So I said, okay, I'll see you later. So I went to walk out the door, and before I could get out to the door, he ran up and put his arms on my shoulder. I turned around, and he said, "Thanks." You know, then I knew then that I reached him.
If Sonny was disgraced after the first Clay fight, after the second one, boy, he really bottomed out. And everybody sort of expected him to just disappear. But Sonny did not disappear. Boxing was his livelihood. He hadn't made nearly as much money as one might suspect he had made. And he continued to fight on.
He went to Sweden. He did exhibition in Sweden. We traveled around and made a few dollars. And then after we came back, we moved to Las Vegas.
Sonny fit in well in Las Vegas. You have to remember, you know, the gambling casinos were founded by gangsters. Sonny fit well into that picture. He wasn't harassed by the cops. People didn't care about his background. You know, he was comfortable there.
Sonny slowly began rebuilding his career. Between 1966 and 69, fighting inferior opponents, he won 14 straight matches. One of his sparring partners was George Foreman, who was an Olympic champion at the time. Ironically, it was during this period that Sonny's image began to soften. He landed a movie role, some TV roles.
Are you married?
Married? Are you kidding? I can get any dame I want. All I have to do is to put out my hand and grab.
Remember, there's an inherent beauty in soup cans that Michelangelo could not have imagined existed.
Talkative Andy Warhol and Gabby Sonny Liston always fly Braniff.
After Sonny moved to Vegas, he became more and more under the influence of Ash Resnick.
He started hanging around with the wrong people. Friends of his were told by police out in Las Vegas that Sonny's hanging out with the wrong folks. There's a drug deal going down and Sonny's involved in it.
There were all kinds of allegations as to what Sonny was doing. There were those that say he'd gone back to his old job as collecting debts for the mob. There were those that say he was pushing heroin. But Sonny was pretty much just being Sonny Liston, doing the same kind of things, associating with the same kind of people he always had.
There were the two faces of Sonny Liston. One of the faces was this man who was totally abstinent, perfectly well-behaved, but around people that he ran with in the night, he behaved another way. There was a Jekyll and Hyde aspect to his personality.
Any chance that Sonny had it for another shot at the title was lost in 1969 after he was knocked out by a former sparring partner, Leotis Martin. After that, Sonny had just one more fight. In June of 1970, he fought Chuck Wepner, who was known as the Bayonne Bleeder. It's a typical Wepner fight. He bled all over the place, and Sonny won on a TKO. Sonny was paid $13,000. Right away, he paid $10,000 of that to repay a loan, and the other $3,000 he gave to his cornerman. He wound up with nothing, and he had nothing. He was, at that point, he was just about broke.
His wife, Geraldine, was out of town over the New Year holidays. She had tried to reach Sonny on the phone, but she couldn't get him. And she cut her holiday short because she was worried.
She arrives in Las Vegas around 8:30, 8:45, and drives home. She pulls up to the house on Ottawa Drive, and she notices that lights are all out in the house.
Well, I went in the back carport, and I went through the few steps up. And it was a terrible smell. So I went in and I said, ooh, you know, I said, he must have cooked and left something on the stove. So I went in the kitchen and I didn't see anything. So I went a few more little steps up to the bedroom, and I seen him laying to his side. I said, I think Sonny's dead.
He has nothing on but a T-shirt, and his head is back on the bed and canted to one side, and there's blood coming out of his nostrils and some kind of foam. And she realizes he's dead, and she screams, Sonny's dead. What happens after this is kind of murky.
I called my attorney and told him that Sonny was dead. He said, how you know he's dead? I said, well, he's laying, I can see he's swolled up, you know? So he said, well, lock up and don't say anything.
I think Geraldine is under the impression that a phone call was made to the authorities shortly thereafter, like 15 minutes.
He said, call your doctor and call the police, and that's what it did, like in 15, 20 minutes.
But in fact, a large amount of time passed, something closer to 2 or 3 hours, before the authorities were called.
Is it a mystery to me, too? I don't know. I'm telling you, the police was right there in about 5 to 10 minutes.
Sonny Liston, the former heavyweight boxing champion, was found dead last night in his Las Vegas home by his wife. He was 38. He had been dead for at least a week. An autopsy failed to show the cause of death, and further studies will be made. Police said that they found small quantities of what appeared to be heroin and marijuana in the home.
We came upstairs, and on entering the bedroom, I observed the body of a black male adult, obviously been deceased some time, laying on his back, looking at the ceiling, and quite swollen and really in terrible shape. I was directed to the kitchen area by the investigating officers, and in this area they had located some narcotic paraphernalia, a small baggie of grass, a small balloon of heroin.
So it appeared to us at that point that he got a overdose of drugs, whether it was by shooting up too much in that short time period or whatever.
There was far too many hours passed between the time that Mrs. Liston entered the house and found the body and when the actual call was made to our department. Time to remove things, to change things. Where was the surgical tubing that he would have probably used to wrap around his arm to expose a vein? Where was the spoon used for cooking? Had it been moved? None of this stuff was present. And of course, you know, the lack of things can be as suspicious as actual items of evidence there.
It wasn't uncommon for family members in these cases to go through and tidy up, so to speak, the crime scene or the scene to save face, to save family embarrassment.
At the autopsy, Dr. Clark pointed out to Mr. Carroll some scars on the arms of Sonny Liston, which at that time appears they were interpreted as needle marks.
We spent at least all day working with this. He screened out the presence of many drugs and found heroin present.
The cause of death being an accidental overdose, that could very well be, but was it self-inflicted or was it administered by someone else?
There's all kinds of speculation. The kindest speculation is that Sonny had got into shooting up heroin, maybe a little joy popping or something like that, and had taken a little bit too much and his heart had given out on him.
People say, well, he couldn't have done drugs. He was afraid of needles. Other people say, oh no, he was a drug addict.
He had a dentist. And the dentist was quoted in various columns that Sonny, you know, the big bad Sonny Liston, was deathly afraid of needles.
He didn't even like to get shot. That was the only thing, you know. And so I says, I don't think that he would let someone just put something to go through his veins.
One coroner at the autopsy said that he saw old needle tracks on Sonny's arm. If in fact he had old needle tracks in his arm, then that destroys the argument that Sonny could not have been a heroin addict because he was deathly afraid of needles.
The other school of thought is that Sonny was given a hot shot, an intentional overdose of heroin to kill him. Why? Well, there are some people saying that he was getting too big for his britches. He was trying to muscle in on some of the underground characters he was working for, getting too big for his britches, and they decided that this was the way to dispose of Sonny.
Harold Conrad, his old friend from the fight days, says that he had gotten involved muscling in on somebody's loan sharking business and that he was murdered over this dispute, over territory, loan sharking territory. Others say that he had had a dispute with a fight promoter out there named Ash Resnick, and that Resnick had a contract taken out on him. And the contract was executed by a colleague.
The story was that Sonny was going around Vegas shooting off his mouth, claiming that Resnick had fixed either one or both of his fights with Ali. And because of this, Resnick had supposedly taken out a contract on Sonny, who was then killed by a hot shot, an overdose of heroin. In spite of the drugs found in Liston's body and the suspicious circumstances surrounding his death, the coroner still listed his death as resulting from natural causes. As a result, the police just dropped the case. There was no further investigation.
The funeral procession went down the strip, and people came out of the casinos to pay homage to Sonny Liston. And the ironic thing about it was that Sonny, to the end, had a police escort, even down the strip. I thought that was the perfect touch. He had a police escort in St. Louis, he had a police escort in Philadelphia, he had a police escort in Denver, and he ended up with a police escort in Las Vegas.
The tragedy of Liston as a man was that I don't think he was ever understood by the public that he was dealing with. And he never knew how to make that public understand him.
I know all the bad things that Sonny did, or at least enough of them, you know. And I can't make excuses for a lot of the stuff that he did. But I think Sonny Liston had so many light years to come.
Many times I was around with Sonny Liston, he, see, you like me, don't you? Like a little kid would, you know. I said, sure I like you. He said, you know, I like you too. I think because of his terrible background growing up, he was looking for somebody who didn't criticize him and who didn't want to hit him with a club or a stick.
Sonny brought a lot of this stuff on himself. There's no question about it. There is nonetheless an undercurrent of sadness about Sonny Liston, and I feel it for him because he was born without a chance. On some level of his life, he was a stranger to everybody who knew him in a way, because he was one guy to one person and one guy to another. Nobody knows exactly when he was born, and very appropriately, nobody knows exactly the day he died. Here's a man who didn't know himself, and I don't know if anybody else really knew the whole Sonny Liston either.
This has been a presentation of HBO Sports, the network of champions.